How many times have you heard that LINQ is slow? Did you see any numbers to confirm that, maybe? In this video, I will be crunching numbers for you under more than 20 different conditions. Every iteration method will show its face in my benchmark. After that, I will look into a realistic business application measuring a string processing query on a complex domain model. I will compare LINQ, common loops, and spans. Get ready to be surprised. Many times. Here's the benchmark class. I want to test the iteration speed when processing the simplest data, integer numbers. That would be the number crunching task, so I will need numbers. I will run the benchmark on a good old C-style array, a list, and a dynamically evaluated sequence. I will enforce a lazy evaluation of numbers, but materialize the two collections before the run. So the question is, what is the fastest way to iterate through these three kinds of data? Let me give you a few ideas. We can use the C-style for loop on a local variable or an indirect array. The for loop on the local array will be the baseline. We can also foreach through the array, repeat the process for a list, for and foreach loops. Now, which one of these methods do you expect to be the fastest one? There are more ways to sum the numbers up. We can foreach through any collection or a sequence using its innumerable implementation. We can also apply LINQ, passing a lambda for the operation on numbers. Again, the question, which method of these do you expect to be the fastest one? And I have one more for you, which uses the specialized LINQ method that sums the integers. I have made 8 iteration methods so far, and I have no clue how they compare to each other when it comes to performance. There's one more approach to crunching numbers that often pops up, using spans. We can either iterate through a common span or through a read-only span. There's a lot of code here already. You can find it all on my Patreon page. Now to benchmarks. It is amusing to see that each and every one of these methods applies to the array. The array is the most fundamental data structure. The list is almost as flexible, with only a little complication when converting it to a span. Lazy evaluated data are limited to manual looping, such as foreach, and to using LINQ. However, there is one common approach to expanding the reach of sequences. Programmers often convert them to the array or the list before applying a fast iteration method to the collection. There are a few other means of iterating through data in .NET. A notoriously complex one hides inside that LINQ sum method. You can read the source code if you are interested to see how they did it there. However, I have over 20 benchmarks for this simple operation, which is way more than I would consider when writing everyday code. Running them will take a while, so let me cut the corner and show you the results. Actual times appear to grow linearly with a growing dimension. That is why we use the relative time to compare implementations. Let me give you my view on the results. The for loop on the local array variable is the baseline. It runs slower on a shared mutable reference to an array because the compiler cannot remove bound checks. The foreach loop, however, always makes a copy of the array reference, so it's always a locally mutable variable. The conclusion, use foreach on arrays. Looping through the list is, however, slower. The list is internally mutable, hence all the costly checks stay. Read-only span is as fast as a local array, adding nothing to arrays. List, however, benefits from spans, as it suddenly behaves like an array. That is an important lesson. If you have a list and need performance, create a read-only span from it. We move to LINQ next. If all you have is an innumerable, then it looks like iterating it will accumulate to a much higher cost. But there is a hidden gem there. I have also used a link to sum up the array and the list, which became the overall fastest method. How? The answer is in reading the link sum method that handles ints. It is about 30 lines of code long. Once it detects that it was called on an array or a list, it applies a very efficient iteration, summation, and overflow checking logic. Lesson learned: use built-in methods whenever they exist. They will have a chance to be more performant than your custom code. The next stage is proper link. We pay high costs to iterate through a collection or a sequence using its enumerable interface. But then, what if all we have got is a lazy evaluated sequence? Any execution method is the same, indicating that the enumeration costs us the most. Lesson learned: it makes no sense to avoid the link when you don't have a collection already. It is the sequence that costs you, not the lambda. Would it help if we collected the input sequence into a fast collection before crunching the numbers? Not so. Collecting the objects already requires iterating the lazy evaluated sequence, and that comes before paying the full cost of summing up. Therefore, the common pattern I see in many code bases, calling two lists before doing anything with the data, turns out to be by far the worst practice in terms of performance. Let me summarize this table. The array is by far the most performant, and so is the list when accessed through a read-only span. But almost invariably, we don't have arrays and lists. We just don't. When it comes to iterating a dynamic sequence, there is no difference between low-level procedural looping and a link with the lambdas. If anyone told you that the link is slow, this result denounces that as a fallacy. Link alone costs you nothing measurable. It is the iteration that costs. The main takeaway is: use spans when possible, use a link liberally when you don't have a collection. Don't turn a sequence into a collection to make it faster. You will make it slower that way. And now, if you got this right, let me show you the last demo. I want to take a sequence of complex domain objects and run a string crunching algorithm on them. Let me advise you that you can download the source code from this video and all other videos on my channel if you join the growing community on my Patreon page. Become the sponsor, help me maintain this channel, and join others on the Discord server associated with this channel. Ask questions, take part in discussions, learn more. All the links are in the description. Now back to code. Look at the domain model. It is a book with a title and some authors. I have already prepared the randomized data in an array to reduce the cost of I/O to an absolute minimum. No data source will ever respond quicker than this one I will use in tests. The task, which I will benchmark, is to find the longest word in all the titles in all the books. Here is the class that will measure that for me. The first attempt will be what I normally do when I write code. Link. Extract all the titles, split them around white spaces, turn them into a sequence of words, eventually selecting the one with the maximum length. Fall back to an empty string if there were no words at all. This is very expressive, but if you fear that select many will take additional time, you're not alone. Let's remedy that by manually doing a pair of nested loops. Though significantly more challenging to develop, I expect this solution to run faster because it is maintaining only two iterators rather than four. But I'm still worried about performance. The string split call creates numerous new strings only to throw them away. Enter spans and the most marvelous piece of imperative logic you will see in this video. Run through strings as read-only spans of characters and maintain the winning word in another span. This method creates nothing until the result is known. The result will be the only new string created here. This solution will be the fastest, no doubt. Hence, I made it a baseline, the moment of truth, running this benchmark. I will cut the corner again and only show you the final result. The relative times are consistent across test cases. The spans are by far the fastest, as expected. The imperative solution with the nested foreach loops is slower by a factor of 2. And the link solution based on the select menu operator is slower by roughly 25% more. If performance is what you need, then the story ends here. Use read-only spans. But raw speed is not the only variable there. Look at the problem size of 100. That would be a large response in any typical web page. And still the slowest method completes it in 15 microseconds. That makes it possible to handle almost 70,000 requests per second per CPU core. That is certainly not a bottleneck. Then we turn to other attributes of code: complexity, maintainability, testability, and bug count. Depending on the formatting style, the code runs from 1 to 3 lines to 12 in the most optimized one. And I didn't even count the curly braces. Nesting levels tell us how simple or complex the code is to the eye. It runs from 1 in LINQ to 4 and 5 in imperative solutions. More formally, the cyclomatic complexity is 1 in LINQ, 3 in nested loops, and a staggering 5 in the most optimized method. That determines the number of unit tests required to cover each method, ranging from 2 over 4 to 6 in the last method. Unless you do have those wretched 70,000 requests per second, LINQ is the clear winner. It brings simplicity, low bug count, and high maintainability compared to the other two solutions. Sometimes you will need to optimize, and in that case, look for spans. Otherwise, look at the bigger picture. You can squeeze 5 microseconds in. Yes, you can. Still, nobody will notice that your code is faster by 5 microseconds. Nobody can see that. And everybody will see how large your code base has become, how many new bugs you have added by complicating your code for the sake of 5 microseconds. Keep that lesson close to your heart. Stay on my channel, subscribe, watch other videos I have made. Start from this video here.